观察中国的政治经济与社会发展？世界各国又是如何看待中国的影响力？而两岸间有哪些焦点议题与新闻事件？深入解析，多面向的透视中国，欢迎收听《这样看中国》。
各位听众大家好，这里是中央广播电台台湾之音，我是这样看中国主持人陈冠廷。今天非常非常的荣幸再次邀请到华府知名智库德国马歇尔基金会中国事务分析师的白若诗先生。白若诗分析师上次来的时候也跟我们精彩的分析美国跟欧洲对中国的一些最新情势的外交应对，这一次我们邀请到白若诗先生来是要更进一步的跟我们分析最近许多台美关系的进展，特别是美国在印太面对中国的挑战，还有最新的这个21世纪台美倡议啊等等的这个事务。那首先我们先请白先生跟大家打声招呼。
谢谢大家。
白先生你好。那这一次白先生会先用英文回应，那我们接下来就是在翻译。首先白先生怎么看未来美国在印太面对中国的挑战，特别是在这个 IPEF 的倡议之后，以及在俄乌战争之后，那 IPEF 就是所谓的印太经济框架。
Thank you so much for having me on. So I think that the future that the U.S. sort of faces in the Indo-Pacific, given the IPEF initiative, as well as the Russian-Ukrainian war, is a broader recognition.That the U.S. needs to work closer with partners and allies to not only continue to deter China from wanting to take military action against Taiwan, but also to make sure that there's more of an understanding of where other democracies can work together to rise to the challenges that have been posed by China's rise in more muscular foreign policy, as well as what's going on in the Russian-Ukrainian war.I think some of the bigger lessons that Taiwan could take from this, especially within the context of the United States, is learning where do officials in the United States and Taiwan really see eye to eye on certain topics and certain issues. And that can range from, you know, defense talks that are, you know, kept behind the scenes to really trying to shore up Taiwan's ability to help the global semiconductor supply chains to ensure that both the United States and Taiwan can navigate those issues together. I also think that the United States has a role to ensure that officials in other democracies across the world, especially within the context of Europe, which has already, you know, fostered a very strong relationship with some places across the European Union and NATO, to ensure that officials inBrussels, as well as other European capitals, are thinking about Taiwan's role within the context of potentially a future U.S.-China or Taiwan-China conflict, but also ensuring that Taiwan continues to be a valuable international partner when it comes to things like sanctions implementation or when it comes to navigating global supply chain shortages for food. I think that's...those are some of the biggest challenges the United States faces when it comes to China and the Indo-Pacific, especially after the Russian-Ukrainian war.
非常感谢这个白先生的分享。分享我就简单的用意译而不是逐字翻译。那当然这一次针对这个问题，他说最重要的是美国跟他的盟国一起来吓阻中国。吓阻中国当然就是指直接对台湾的安全上面的这种侵犯。除此之外，更重要的就是让所有的这些民主的国家们能够一起在这个平台上共同合作。其实不仅仅是在这个中国，在乌克兰与俄罗斯侵略乌克兰之后，这些更加的重要。那这也是一个非常好的机会，让所有的领袖们、官员们能够直接凝视着对方的双眼啊，好好的思考一下有哪些重要的议题是必须要去进行讨论的。其实有非常多广泛的议题，特别在俄乌战争之后，当然我们面临到的是半导体的这个供应链也好， 或者是其他的台湾的重要的角色都必须要思考。最近在这个俄乌战争之后，还有粮食的短缺等等，这是台湾都必须跟美国一起讨论的议题。那其实不仅仅是美国，还有美国的盟邦，特别是在欧洲的盟邦，在北约组织等等。当我们想到台湾的时候，请不要仅仅只有想到冲突而已，其实还有更多不同的角色，如同刚才所讲到的我们有在半导体的产业链里面，在供应链里面扮演了非常重要的角色。在台湾不仅仅是只有冲突，它能够在国际社会里扮演正面的有意义的角色，那包含之前对这个俄国的制裁等等，我们都可以看到台湾都是站在世界的这一个自由民主的一方。那我们紧接着想请教白老师第二个问题，您觉得台湾会是下一个直接面临地缘冲突的国家吗？
So I don't know if Taiwan will be the next guaranteed security threat after Ukraine. I do think that it's a potential flashpoint that needs to continue to be monitored and needs to make sure that the United States and U.S. allies and partners work with Taiwan to ensure that Taiwan has the adequate defense capabilities to deter a Chinese invasion, and if it were to actually happen, repel and any sort of armed activity against Taiwan or its outer islands. I do think that because of the Russo-Ukrainian war, there rightfully so is a deeper concern across the Indo-Pacific that a Taiwan conflict could happen. And also the images that we're seeing from Ukraine since the beginning of the war and the end of February, especially as someone who really enjoys Taiwan, was very haunting to me. Looking at people huddling for shelter in the Kyiv metro, you know, is shocking. And I don't want the same thing to happen to Taiwan. And I don't say that to be alarmist or anything. I think for right now, Taiwan is fine. I do think that this is a warning call that Taiwan needs to start really thinking about how to work on its asymmetrical defense capability. And where can the United States, as well as other places like Australia or Japan or, you know, other parts of the world can really help Taiwan figure out those different defense capabilities. Because as the most recent war game I participated in for television here in the United States showed, there is a concern that if a conflict were to happen, it could quickly escalate to being more global in scope. And to ensure that Taiwan is able to defend itself if China were to come and do any sort of military action towards it, I think is really key. And that's what the U.S. really needs to take a lead on in conjunction with officials in Taiwan, you know, as well.
非常感谢白先生的分析。那白先生说他不确定台湾会不会是下一个，但是他确实是一个可能潜在会面临冲突的地方。我们必须要好好的去观察，并且时时警惕发生在乌克兰的事情。那当然，相信美国也会与台湾有更密切的合作，确保台湾有足够的装备、武力去吓阻中国来侵略台湾。那其实在乌克兰战争之后，在印太地区确实是非常令人担心，在乌克兰基辅发生的事情，特别是让这些担心或者是关心台湾的感到难过。当初这个二月底的时候，俄罗斯侵略他们的首都基辅的时候，看到许多基辅的市民都在去寻找防空洞，这样子的画面看得十分令人不忍。当然这不代表说台湾现在就马上要面临到这样子的挑战或冲突，但是要准备并且特别是专注在非对称的战争上是非常重要的一部分。那美国不仅仅是唯一的盟邦，其实包含像是在澳洲啊、日本啊这些种种的这些国家都是美方的伙伴，也是台湾的伙伴。那可以一起来思考怎么样能够确保台湾拥有这些的武器装备去防范中国的入侵。那 其实就如同白先生所说的，现在的任何一个战争都可能会不断升级到全球的这个威胁，所以这是令人要非常警惕的。所以未来美国最好能够更加的紧密与台湾的这些官员们能够共同的去思考怎么样能够让台湾的装备能够面临这样子的挑战。非常感谢白先生给我们非常详尽的分享。那节目到这一边，我们先休息一下，稍后回来。
向全世界传开永恒的关怀，来自台湾之音 RTI。 从两岸、国际、历史、文化与财经等角度透视中国的这样看中国节目，每周一到周五晚间9:30到10:00在中央广播电台播出。如果您对这样看中国节目有任何收听想法或意见，欢迎寄信到台北市北安路55号，也可以透过电子邮件的方式。节目有两个信箱，2020@rti.org.tw 或是2020-0203news@gmail.com。 再次谢谢听众朋友们的收听与支持，请持续锁定每周一到周五晚间9:30到10:00播出的《这样看中国》节目。
大家好，我是侨务委员会委员长洪振源。很开心向大家宣布，2022年海外华文媒体报道大奖开始征件了。本届海外华文媒体报道大奖，在聚焦台湾、报道台湾的核心理念下，将以全球变局下的变与不变，发挥海外华媒影响力为主题，鼓励在动荡时局下，能秉持媒体报道的核心价值，提供事实真相和优质作品参赛。参赛类别分为平面网络报道类、广播报道类、电视影音报道类以及侨务电子报新闻报道特别奖。欢迎踊跃报名参加，在全球变局下的变与不变中，一起让世界看见华文媒体的影响力。
新冠肺炎疫情来势汹汹，要怎么办？
别担心，只要确实的勤洗手，就能有效防范哦。
对对对，洗手口诀我都记住了，要内外夹攻大力丸，
彻底清洁手掌、手背、指背、指缝，还有大拇指跟手腕。最重要的是，整个过程要搓洗40到60秒，才算是有效的洗手哦。
RTI 中央广播电台，跟你一起守护健康。
世界传开永恒的关怀，来自台湾之音 RTI。
各位听众大家好，这里是中央广播电台台湾之音，我是这样看中国主持人陈冠廷。那今天非常荣幸访问到华府智库德国马歇尔基金会的中国事务分析师白若诗先生来空中跟我们相会。白先生，我们上面两题我们是谈到了这个 IPEF， 我们谈到台湾是不是可能的下一个地缘冲突，那我想要请教白先生，您怎么看21世纪台美贸易倡议之后的展望呢？
So I think that it's a good development because I think that it emphasizes wanting to push closer trade cooperation and overall trade between the U.S. and Taiwan. I think outside of the context of China and some of its economic coercion against Taiwan in recent years and historically, there are many reasons for why the U.S. and Taiwan need to be on the same page when it comes to, you know, trade overall. And I think the launch of the U.S.-Taiwan Initiative on 21st Century Trade has the capability to address some of those issues, especially when it related to, you know, the import of U.S. beef and whatnot over, you know, recent years. One thing that sticks out to me about the initiative, which I think is very underrated within the context of more recent developments in the Pacific, is I really like the part that discusses supporting environment and climate action in terms of talking about cooperation and joint approaches on trade and the environment, and, you know, supporting COP26 outcomes and exchanging information, green jobs, etc. I think that this is a place where the U.S. and Taiwan can be very active together, especially as it relates to Taiwan's diplomatic allies in the Pacific. As we've seen with the most recent situation in the Pacific Islands as it relates to Australia and China, some of the countries there didn't feel that China could offer a good alternative when it comes to fighting climate change or when it comes to providing more sustainability options. I think that that's a really wide open area in which the United States and Taiwan can cooperate across the entire region, and not just related to independent countries within the Pacific, but also for U.S. territories and affiliated, you know, U.S. Free Association Compact countries across the region.
非常感谢白先生的分享。白先生认为这是一个非常好的举措，那他也提到说这是一个很好的一个对话的机制，让台湾能够不用在中国的背景下，或者是透过中国经济胁迫的背景下，能够与美国谈可能的这种贸易，还有这样促进贸易的举措。所以这是非常鼓舞人心的。那另外一部分他觉得必须要特别强调，就是说在这一次的倡议里面有特别谈到了环境问题还有气候问题，那这一种讨论常常会被低估重要性，但其实是非常重要的。这不仅仅在这个贸易的这个倡议里面有谈到他们会去支持，他们还谈到会去促成这些绿色工作的这种岗位，绿色工作的这个应该是说工作机会，并且更加的有动力的去参与这些绿色相关的产业事务。那他认为这件事非常具备不仅仅是象征意义，而且是非常有意义的。那千万不要忘记，台湾有许多的友邦都是在太平洋地区，不仅仅是台湾的友邦，包含美国的这些海外领土也是坐落在此地区。那这些地区是可以让台湾跟他的友邦还有美国共同去协力合作，来去对抗气候变迁对这些国家的这种侵蚀的。最近当然大家应该也就注意到中国的外长也有去拜访太平洋这些岛国，可能是因为在特别是在这个气候变迁跟绿色的这个相关的议题上面，中国比较没有办法提出好的解决方案，所以这也是台湾美国跟其盟友能够一同去开发的可能性之一。非常感谢白先生给我们的分享。您认为台湾除了针对美国经贸的议题之外，有没有可能在安全的领域上面有更深层的合作，比方说参与环太平洋军演啊等等？
I think there are many opportunities for the United States and Taiwan to participate in deeper security cooperation that, for example, might not even have to do with RIMPAC, although I think that that's something many Taiwanese officials would want. I can't really speak to the thought process for the United States and other partners that attend, you know, facilitating that. What I do think the United States and Taiwan can do is cooperate more in the realm of cybersecurity, as well as mm-hmm. critical infrastructure protection. I think mm-hmm. that those are two very, I want to say ripe, but two very good fields in which the United States and Taiwan both have had issues related to ransomware and other sort of cyber intrusion issues, where protecting the critical infrastructure of Taiwan should be a important aspect of U.S.-Taiwan security cooperation. So the United States and Taiwan both face many different cybersecurity issues and threats, like ransomware and other cyber issues. I think the war in Ukraine shows the importance of having critical infrastructure that can continue to function in the time of crises. And I think being able to help Taiwan have that capability, in addition to protecting peacetime critical infrastructure networks, it should be a priority for the United States. And there are several different government agencies in the United States that could deepen that cooperation.
非常感谢白分析师的分享。他认为未来当然有很多机会能够加深加强台美之间的安全合作，但是不一定只有所谓的黄太平洋军演而已。当然或许有很多台湾的这些朋友们对此都非常感兴趣，他也不能够代表这些官方立场，但是他认为其实还有很多其他的面向是可以合作的，比方说在网络安全上面，以及在重要的基础建设的保护上面，这都是一个非常好的可能性可以去一起去合作的。那在美国有很多的官方机构可以提供这一些经验的，那包含其实不仅仅是台湾会面临这些问题，美国也会面临勒索软体啊，这个网际网络的骇客的入侵等等，这些都是现在迫切且真实的危险。乌克兰发生的事情更给我们很大的一些教训，在战争时期，在危机时期，他们怎么样能够确保国家的这些基础建设能够持续运作，这些也是我们希望台湾能够帮助台湾去具备的。不仅仅如此，在成平时期、和平时期，怎么样建制这一些机制也是非常非常重要的。
Yes, so I think that there's more space for that cooperation. I think, for example, the United States can ensure that Taiwan has proper cybersecurity when it comes to its energy supply and energy companies. Same thing would go for its electrical network, as well as other forms of critical infrastructure. So I think it's important for the United States to use platforms and forums like the Global Cooperation and Training Framework Program in order to help Taiwan fulfill the needs within other security areas, to include protecting critical infrastructure. I also think it's important for GCTF to bring in other partners for Taiwan from places like not only Japan, but potentially NATO partners or Australia and other countries that have a lot of experience with handling, protecting critical infrastructure. I think the war in Ukraine with Russia has left many officials across the European Union and NATO more skeptical of China, either because they view them as being complicit in the war or at least acquiescent in the war that Russia is waging. And I think that that provides an opportunity for Taiwan to be able to deepen those ties with all the governments that it can across NATO or across the European Union to combat non-traditional security areas like protecting critical infrastructure.
那白先生持续的说，其实未来合作空间其实更广，包含在刚才我们提到的，除了这个网际的安全之外，我觉得就是网络安全之外，还有在能源的这个供应安全，还有特别是一些重要的电子系统的安全等等，这都是未来可以跟美国或者是其他盟友讨论的重心。那他也特别谈到 GCPF， 就是 Global Cooperation Training Framework， 那中文就是全球合作暨训练架构，那主要由台湾、美国、日本跟澳洲都有非常积极的参与。透过这个机制，白先生认为就能够更容易的可以让这些各个国家的官署的机关能够派一些代表过来与台湾在这些重要的基础建设措施上面能够共同合作。那未来其实他认为不仅仅是日本、澳洲，甚至其他可能的北约的盟国都能够一起在这个机制下训练合作。那在这一次的乌克兰跟俄罗斯战争之后，其实世界各国特别是民主国家呢，对中国的不信任感其实是不断的在提升，所以如何让台湾能够具备反制非传统安全威胁的能力就变得非常至关重要。所以在这些的安全议题上面，我们可以透过 GCTF 的全球的这个机制与美国合作。非常感谢白先生今天在这个美国也蛮晚的的时间跟我们连线。那白先生在上一次也是分析了许许多多的重要的事物。那白先生这一次是第二次来参加我们节目的录音，那我们认为透过与国外的知名的学者这样子的交流，可以让世界不仅仅是听到台湾的声音，也可以让在中国的朋友们能够听到自由的声音。那不见得只有我们来自台湾，其实来自世界各地，正因为我们是自由民主的国家，我们能够吸取不同的经验，分享不同的这些文化、历史、政治、经济的事物给所有的听众。那我们未来也会持续的努力来邀请到更多国内外知名的媒体啊、学者啊，一同跟听众们分享最新的资讯。这里是中央广播电台台湾之音，我是主持人陈冠廷，再次感谢您的收听，我们下周再会。